Hello and welcome to the Lharbur Show. My name is Luke Harbur. I am your host. And today I have the wonderful Sly James with me. He is the former mayor and was the former mayor of Kansas City. Mr. Sly James, how are you today?
I'm great, Luke. How you doing?
I'm doing fantastic, man.
Glad to hear it.
Are you ready for the first segment of Harbur Hot Takes?
I believe I am, Luke. Let's give it a shot, man.
Fantastic. Right. Okay, so Sly here has three topics that he's going to be given, and he has only one sentence to share his opinion for these three topics. So without further ado, right, here we go. Sly, topic number one. What is your one sentence opinion on taxes?
Necessary, but should be moderated.
Okay, that's very good. Okay, number two. What is your definition of service?
Selfless devotion to seeing that others have what they need in order to thrive.
Amazing. Okay, great. So clear and concise. That's amazing. Okay. And
I only have one sentence.
Well, it's true. I know, right? But there are people who use like semicolons and commas and like try to work their way around it. You're doing great.
Thanks.
You're welcome. And number three, what is your opinion in one sentence on weed?
Should be legalized, controlled, and disseminated across ethical and equitable lines.
Wow. Look at this guy getting it all done. Way to go, man. And now for our second segment, which is Harbor Talk. Sly here is going to have three different topics that we're going to explore that are considered relatively taboo within a 9-minute period. And we can go on and talk about those topics as long as or as short as we want to within the 9-minute time limit. Does that
okay.
sound good?
Yeah, fine.
Okay, great. You ready to jump in?
Go for it.
Okay, we are starting the timer in 3, 2, 1. So Sly, the first topic that I really want to talk about, and I just want to put it out, it's my question to you, is making promises within politics on any level, be it local, state, federal, et cetera. Why do you think that's a taboo topic to discuss?
Well, for one, I don't think promises mean anything. Promises are meant to appeal to a segment of voters who want something. And in order for you to acquire their vote, you'll promise them that you'll deliver it. Now, the problem with that is that you've got to think about what is required in order to deliver on a campaign promise. The bureaucracy has to drop what it's doing and turn its attention to whatever resource allocations and time allocations and human allocations are necessary in order to deliver on that promise. And that means that the things that should be continued that address chronic problems, sustainable solutions to chronic problems, are abandoned. Perfect example. If a politician comes into office, one of the first things that they do is try to distinguish themselves from whoever they're running against. Mm-hmm. So they either tear down that person's programs, talk about how ineffective they are, how bad they are, how costly they are, whatever, and then talk about what they're going to do. And in the course of doing that, they make a promise. So if you look at what the person who they're challenging is actually doing, some of those things might be worth keeping. They may be in the best interest of the people that they're supposed to be serving. Perfect example, healthcare. Mm-hmm. Yes. So as a matter of politics, the incoming party wanted to destroy Obamacare or the ACA. Now, the ACA was a flawed bit of legislation. However, it had one major accomplishment, and it got more people than ever before into the healthcare system and on insurance. Mm-hmm. That's a good thing. So if you agree that having more people having access to healthcare is a good thing, the real idea should be to improve on the vehicle, the legislation. Make it better, don't tear it apart. The only reason you wanted to tear it apart was because it was done by the other party and a different person. Mm-hmm. But the people who got screwed in that whole process were the people who needed insurance. So what's the promise? We're going to get rid of Obamacare. And you try and try and try and get rid of Obamacare. And you chip away at it and you make it so untenable that you do get rid of it. Right. Where are the people who had health care? Where are they? They have nothing. Now, the politician who wanted to get rid of it has won. Right. And kept that promise. but the people who are really needed to be served are left behind. Yeah. So making promises shifts the focus away from doing what is necessary for the people in the constituency and does more to help the politician make a promise so that they can then run again and say, I told you I was going to do it. I did it. Vote for me again. It's all about politics. The problem with that is that politics is not necessarily leadership, and politics is not always service.
Sure. I, as someone who has not been involved in politics a lot, but has been a pretty big observer of it, there are a lot of agendas that seem to happen. So that can really skew a voter's or a constituent's point of view on a politician, right, which is hard because at the end of the day, whether you're Donald Trump or Sly James, seriously, you're human.
Yeah.
You know, you have a life outside of your political office that you're trying to navigate. And when it comes to making those promises, you can't fulfill all of them.
Well, the problem is you shouldn't be making promises anyhow.
Right.
Okay. I mean, seriously, you shouldn't make promises because you can't keep them. And the one thing that I learned a long time ago is don't promise what you don't keep. And if you're not there in office, you don't know what you can and cannot deliver. The second thing is that there is no promise worth making that you can guarantee to deliver on your own. Everything of any value or any size or any heft requires other people to be engaged.
Yes.
You can't, there's no single person who can fix the healthcare system. That requires Congress, that requires the Senate, that requires states, that requires insurance companies, lobbyists, pharmaceutical companies, all sorts of different people.
A lot of moving parts.
Exactly. So how in the hell can you promise to do one thing right, when you don't control all those moving parts? Don't
yes,
promise. Tell people the truth. Here's what we need to do. Here's how we can get it done. There are no promises, but if we can get everybody working together on it, we can get this done, and that includes the public. They have to understand that. One of the things that I think makes people cynical about politics is they've had too many politicians make promises to them that they could not keep.
Yeah.
And if you have somebody say to you time and time again, Luke, I'm going to be there at 9. I'll be there at 9. And they don't show up. Or Luke, I'm going to come over for dinner. And they don't show up.
Make you irritated.
The next time
curious,
you talk about them, you just don't believe a damn thing they say. And you don't
right,
even bother to prepare dinner because you know they're not going to show.
And actions speak louder than words at
bingo,
the end of the day.
And promises are not actions. They're only words.
Beautifully said. And that goes into our second topic I want to talk to you about
sure,
today. It comes from one of our audience members. Tell me about the taboo topic of politics behind the scenes. And why do you think someone would think this is taboo to talk about?
Well, because it's like anything else. I'm also a lawyer, and I know that one of the things that happens is that the language of law and the processes of law shut people who are not lawyers out of the system, and it insulates lawyers from basically some level of scrutiny. Politics behind the scenes is often filled with money. Money is a huge driving force. It's often filled with people who are mean-spirited, not always, and it's often filled with people who are idealistic but wind up being co-opted. But politics, particularly if you're talking about party politics, is driven more for the purpose of one party beating another as opposed to actually accomplishing some of the things that need to be done. And it's one of those situations where absolute power corrupts absolutely. And I think we're seeing that on state levels and in federal levels, where one party in power, able to force its will on another, does what it wants. And the reason they do it isn't necessarily because it's in the best interest of people. It's necessary because it's best interest in perpetuating the power of that party. Okay,
mm-hmm.
That party wants to stay in power. They're going to do things that keep them in power. That does not necessarily serve the people that they're supposed to be serving. So the underbelly of politics is self-interest, money, over-influence of lobbyists and people who have money, and basically shutting out two major groups of people who are really somewhat powerless, the very young kids, and the very old. If you're not in a productive part of your life, politics really doesn't address or even try to address your needs in most instances. You have to be producing something from the economy or for the economy before you get a lot of play.
Right.
Who lobbies for kids ages 0 to 5?
Right.
And who lobbies for old people? AARP is about it. And that's a consolidation of old people.
Yeah.
And the reason that they have any power at all is because they actually vote. Young kids don't vote.
Yeah, they don't have that privilege.
Exactly.
That's very beautiful.
Not only that, they can't drive. So.
Right. They literally can't go anywhere.
They can't go anywhere without an adult. Yeah. You're zero to five, you just can't go anywhere.
Very well said. And the last segment I want to talk to you today about, it's something that you want to talk about and I love to explore it with you, is the topic of hostility. Now, let's talk about why you think that might be a taboo topic within the realm of what we spoke about.
Yeah.
You know, with family, for example.
Right.
Tell me about that.
Well, I think it's particularly important in this day and age where people are so divided. Everybody is in their own camp. It is very easy to watch a family tear itself apart about politics or social issues, depending on which news stations they watch.
Yeah. Right.
You know?
100%.
And it's not like, I remember I was watching something the other day and they were talking about the impeachment of Nixon and why, when there was an impeachment of Nixon, the Congress voted 402-4 or something like that to allow subpoenas in order to process the impeachment process. 402. Everybody was in favor of it. Mm-hmm. The answer was there was only three news stations, ABC, NBC, and
right.
CBS. And they were all saying the same thing. They were all sprouting the same facts. Now, you got Fox saying one thing. You got MSNBC saying something else. You got CNN.
Saying something
you got
else.
Bloomberg. You got 50,000 news stations running 24/7, 365.
Right.
And they're all saying something different. If you've ever watched the same story reported on MSNBC and then on Fox.
I have.
It's like.
It's wild.
It's like different two different
reality.
Things.
It's literally presenting a different reality with the same situation.
So if you only watch Fox, then your reality is over here. And if you only watch MSNBC, your reality is over there. And if that's happening in your families, you get downright hostile.
Yes.
Because people do not know how to resolve political conflict without hostility. It's evolved into a point now where I'm right and you're wrong. And if you don't agree with me, I want nothing to do with you.
Right.
You can't talk about politics in a lot of circumstances without hostility coming to the forefront.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really unfortunate. But we've all staked out our position so strongly that even in families where there's disagreement, where there's different people in different parties, you can have things tear down along political lines. I know of families where things have happened and one part of the family doesn't speak to the other because of politics and their level of hostility. That's the level of destructiveness that it wasn't so much that the Russians wanted to get Trump to win if when they were interfering, and I do believe they did. They wanted to do exactly what's happening, divide the American public and make us rudderless in terms of how we respond to world events so that they can take advantage of it.
Yeah.
And I think they've done a damn good job of it, and they're continuing to do a good job of it, and we're too stupid to pull our act together in order to stop it.
Yeah.
There are people who believe that history, the things that have happened in history, the rise and fall of civilizations and empires and governments, can't happen here.
Right.
That just goes to show how young we are.
Oh, we are so young.
We're like teenagers telling the parents who've been in governments for hundreds of years before, we know more than you do.
And you can't tell us what to do.
That's right. And then we take the car out after they said, don't drive the car tonight. It's raining, it's slick outside, and you drive too fast. We take the car out, run it into a tree, and then come back and say, sorry.
Oops. Yeah. Well, Sly, it has been nothing but a joy and a pleasure. Thank you so much
Pleasure's
for coming
mine.
On today.
Absolutely.
Awesome.
Absolutely.
Man.
Fun.
Thank you all so much for watching today. And Sly, thank you so much for being on the show.
Luke, thanks for having me, man. I appreciate it.
Of course. Now, are you ready for the end slate?
Absolutely. Let's rock it out.
Okay, here we go.
Ready?
Pause, play,
be kind,
and
make
a
difference.
We'll see you guys soon. Following you. There we go.
Don't believe it, just why. 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 Hey, 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 oh!